Okay, so let's get on to our next speaker. Our next speaker is world renowned and acclaimed as one of the best inspirational speakers in the world. A successful businessman and author of 3 best-selling books, qualified lifeguard, honored by the World Surf Life Saving Federation, a world-class athlete, and a second-degree black belt in Taekwondo. He's a city councilor. Here are some of his many life achievements, and he has many. He's a scuba diver, a motor racing champion, qualified pilot, and also a snow skier. This amazing person has also scaled the heights of Mount Kilimanjaro. He's raced the salt flats of Bonneville and driven a 2-man bobsled down an Olympic course. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome to the stage my friend, an amazing man, very inspirational, Mr. Tony Christensen. Please be on your feet.
I'm sitting at the back of the room and wonder who the hell is he talking about? Great to be here, thank you. And I see a few of you sitting over the back going, where the hell is he? Look, what he didn't tell you is I don't have any legs and I'm sitting here in my wheelchair. And it was really, look, I've been here with 21st Century Receiver times before. And again, thank you to Jamie and the crew for having me back. And it's really interesting. I come here and I look and I go, you know, I come from the back of the stage, sometimes it's really high, no problem at all. And I came in last night and I looked at the stage and I said, look guys, you need to raise the stage up for me a little bit higher so everybody can see me. And they said, no problem at all. And Joel's gone and stuck a bloody trestle up. Oh man. He knows I can do it. I tried it this morning, my pants fell off. So you guys might get more than what you're bargaining for on the front row, I gotta say. The things you got to do. Hey, look at it. Safety and health approved. Anyway. Yeah, I lost my footing. Much better. I feel like Humpty Dumpty sitting up here. We all know what happened to him, don't we? As I say, it's a great pleasure to be here with you today. And what I'm going to do for just our very short time together is share with you some of my story. You see, I believe that we all have a story in our lives. Now, what do you think the first question is that people ask me when they meet me? Anyone? How'd you lose your legs? In fact, that's the second question that people ask. Because I know most of you ladies are asking, aren't you Brad Pitt? Yeah. Well, it could be, just the shorter version. The second question that people ask is, how did you lose your legs? And when I'm sitting on the local surf beach, I call out, shark! Man, does that clear the water quick. What I can tell you today is that I was run over by a train when I was 9 years old. And I can remember that day like it was yesterday. I can remember pleading with my mum to let me go with my good friend Gary and his dad to the local railway yards where they were bagging coal for a community project. You know, I can still remember the reluctance of my mum's voice when she let me go. I remember walking across the tracks with Gary to get some more sacks to be filled. As we walked back, the 2 40-ton wagons shunted backwards. I was dragged underneath. The next thing I can remember is looking up. Gary's father was leaning over me. He was screaming and crying. I remember going in the ambulance to the local hospital. Mum and Dad were at the emergency room doors and I looked up and I said, I'm sorry, Mum, but I'll be okay. And I woke up 6 days later in intensive care. Mum and Dad were sitting at the end of the bed. I had this really terrible itch on my foot. And I went to scratch it. And that was when they told me that those feet weren't there anymore. Believe me, I can remember that day like it was yesterday. During the time that I was in hospital, 2 good friends of my parents, Dave Franklin, Alan Guthrie, were swimming coaches. And they'd read an article that teaching disabled people to swim was a great form of therapy. So I'd come into this category of life being disabled. And I'm sitting on the edge of the pool one sunny afternoon, like they always are in New Zealand. And I'm thinking to myself, well, this is great. I hate water. I can't swim. I haven't got any legs. How's this going to happen? You know, you teach a dog to swim. You pick it up, you throw it in the water, and it either sinks or swims, right? They picked me up, they threw me, and I sank. And I'm sitting on the bottom of the pool looking up. They got the big net, the one they used to scoop the leaves out with. They got the net, scooped me out of the pool, sat me on the side and said, look, Tony, it's not going to look good on our resume if you drown. We're going to teach you to swim. I remember one length becoming two lengths becoming three. And Dave Franklin walked every one of them with me after 5 months. I swam a mile, which was 52 lengths of that pool nonstop, and I was only just 10 years old. For me, that was my first taste of goal setting. What I could achieve with the right attitude, and I'd say accepting the challenge that life had thrown at me. I remember going through what we have in New Zealand, intermediate and boys' college. At the end of the fifth form year, at the age of 15, they had options. Now these options were we could go away on a camp for a week. We could go and play golf, rugby, soccer, camping and tramping. And I sat down and I thought, well, gee, I don't have a lot of options up here, really. Went on a surf life-saving camp, which again was run by my swimming instructor, Dave Franklin. And at the end of the week-long course, achieving my surf bronze medallion, joining the local surf life-saving club. Beautiful sunny Saturday afternoon, like they always are in New Zealand. My good friend Warren and I, we were the two lifeguards on duty. We were called to a rescue about 4 kilometres from the surf club. So I'm sitting in the sand on my backside, up into the Jeep I climb. Warren drove us off. He pulled the Jeep up close to the short break. We jumped out, put the rescue tubes around ourselves, and there were three young people caught in a rip. There were two young boys about 200 metres offshore. Warren swam out to the boys, and there was a girl of about 17 or 18 years old. Well, obviously I went and got the girl. When I got to her, she was in a great amount of distress, really upset. Calming her down, I assured her that I knew exactly what I was doing. Everything would be just fine. Put the rescue tube around her, and we slowly swam back into the beach. And, you know, I'd say with our conversation, she had this image of a 6'2" bronze lifeguard. Because we're in the short break, the water was up to here on me. I had my arm over her, she was still floating, and I'm dragging her along the sand. We got to the point where she could stand up, because she stood up, looked down at me, looked out at the surf, looked back down at me, and fainted. I gained a reputation of causing her accidents that I saved. For me, it was a very special time in my life. You know, I suppose it was one of those acceptance things because that's what all my friends were doing. And that time of my life, 15, 16 years old, sitting in front of television with my mum and dad, the Olympic Games were on. Now, we've all seen the Olympic Games, the medal presentations, and like many of you, I thought to myself, wouldn't it be an awesome experience to represent your country? Can you imagine what it's like to be up on a podium, receive a medal, have your national anthems play, that proud moment it must be? Oh, from memory, the high jump was on at the time. I wasn't sure I was going to do that one. But, a bit later that year, I was introduced to the disabled sport movement. I went away to the Nationals in Wellington, was selected to go to Japan, and since that time, overseas 6 times to the world in Paralympic Games, many gold, silver, and bronze medals. A story that I'd like to share with you this morning, which is just so dear to my heart, was at the 1980 Paralympics in Arnhem, Holland, and it was the final of the 100 metres backstroke. We're all in the pool getting ready to start. We looked to the side, and they were lifting this young man from Israel out of his wheelchair and putting him into the water. He had spina bifida. He had these little wee short, twisted up arms and a very small body, little wee legs. He was floating away on his back. We started the race, and I finished second in a time of 1 minute 15 seconds. We got out of the pool. We were drying ourselves down. We looked back, and there was this little guy still going. His little wee arms were flipping away. Every now and again, he sank under the water. He came back up. He went out. And it took him 9 minutes to finish the event. On that day, we're up on the podium, receiving our medals, having a national anthem play, that proud moment that I'd always imagined. Do you know, it was a prouder moment when we took our medals off and we offered them to that young man. You see, we felt that his achievement was greater than ours. We won the race. That's what we trained for. you know what? He finished. What that's allowed me to do in my life is to appreciate. Is to appreciate the things that I have. You see, I know many, many disabled people that are far worse off than I am. Yet in saying that, I know many able-bodied people are far more disabled than I'll ever be. Why? Because of their attitudes. Their attitudes to their lives, to their families, to their friends, to their work, to their customers. What are attitudes? I believe attitudes are habits of thought. The way we think about things. If our habits of thought are unenthusiastic, with a lack of desire, it's reflected in our attitude. If our habits of thought are enthusiastic, with a desire to succeed, accept the challenges that life throws at us, that's reflected in our attitude. And I believe that it's our attitudes which determine our level of success in life. See, we all want to be successful, don't we?
Yes. Yeah.
We all want to be successful, don't we?
Yes!
All right. Anybody in the room today that doesn't? Great, I was going to say you're probably in the wrong room. It's all about an attitude, really, isn't it? But what is success? For you to be successful in your life, just share it with me and the others in the room. Call it out. What do you believe success is?
Family?
No.
Happiness?
Living your dream?
Freedom?
100%
gratitude. 100%
gratitude?
Helping others?
Being true to yourself?
Education?
Spirituality? This is great. I don't have to leave till 11. Look, success is something different to each and every one of us. To some it is health, wealth, security, respect, happiness, family, 100%. Being successful in my life is to achieve the goals that are set for myself. Is that something I want to share with you today? Is that I'm a goal setter. I'm a planner. In fact, I'm going to ask another question. How many fellow goal setters here today? Excellent. A few hands. Great. Excellent. Something else I want to share is I'm a dreamer. How many fellow dreamers?
Woo!
Well, there's a lot more of them. I tell you what, sitting up here, I see each and every one of you. Each and every one of your faces. I ask a question. Many of you put your hand up. It's like this. Here's another one. Can you remember the first day you went to school, 5 years old? Okay. Good. I'm looking around. A lot of you probably can't. 5 years old, the teacher would ask the class a question. Before they'd finished asking, what do? Stuck a hand up, didn't know the answer, didn't even know the bloody question. Look at that, pick me. What changes in our lives for us to stop putting our hands up? Hey, have we been told that we're wrong too many times? I read an article several years ago, and it said that the average 17-year-old in both New Zealand and Australia had been told the words no or can't 148,000 times. The challenge we face is that if we hear it enough times, we start to believe it. Or are we too busy worrying about what other people think of it? Oh, you're not one of those, eh? You're not one of those goal setters, eh? You don't want to be successful, do you? I'm here today to tell you, successful people in whatever they choose in life are goal setters. They are planners. They have their plan for today, tomorrow, next week, next month, next year, the next 5 or 10 years of their lives. I actually believe life's like driving a car. You don't steer it, you end up going somewhere you don't want to be. So I'm going to ask again, how many fellow planners?
Yeah.
Excellent.
Yeah.
How many fellow dreamers?
Yeah.
All right, how many procrastinators? Get your hands up and tell you what's a few of you out there. Look at my life, I'm inspired. In my life, I'm inspired by achievements I've seen of people far worse off than I am. I've seen Olympic blind runners do the 100 metres fractions of a second slower than a world able-bodied record. I have seen Olympic high jumpers with one leg jumping centimetres less than the world able-bodied record. In fact, have any of you seen blind soccer players? Anybody here today? Unbelievable, isn't it? Look, they get a ball, right? They fill it full of bells. They throw it in the middle of the paddock and off they go kicking it around. They have two different sounding horns at each end. Unbelievable. I was at the 1988 Paralympics in Seoul, Korea. My friend Bruce was the coach of the New Zealand blind soccer team. I'd finished all of my events. Bruce said, look, Tony, I'm taking the guys to the park for a training session for their game tomorrow. Do you want to come? I said, yeah, that'd be great. So we're in the van down to the park. He opened up the door, got the guys out, picked up the ball, threw it in the middle of the paddock, and off they went kicking it around. Unbelievable. I said to him, what do you do now? He said, oh, I just wait. I said, how long does it take? He said, oh, about half an hour. They don't even know I'm here. Like all good Kiwis, I spotted a bar across the road. I said, mate, we might as well go and sit in the bar. We were in there 10 minutes. Someone came running in and said, who's looking after those blind soccer players across the road? He said, we are. They said, you'd better go and get them. They've lost their ball. They're kicking the crap out of a Hare Krishna. Said ching, ching, ching. Oh, yeah, yeah. That's probably one of those you had to be there things, I suppose, really. At the age of 17 years old, my mum came to me and said, Tony, you've got to go and get a job. Now, we all know at 17 years old, it was to get a job. You see, I thought I didn't have any legs. Wonder what I could do. And then I thought, hey, I don't have any legs. Nobody's going to blame me for not doing anything. But you know, there was someone, and it was me, because I did think, what could I do? My friends were out riding push bikes, climbing trees, doing all of the things that young people did. I spent a lot of time at home. So I started to do drawings and cartoons, graphic art. Then I started to do show cards and posters for local stores and supermarkets. It got to the point my friends were about earning 10 bucks a week doing a paper round. I could earn like 50, 80, $100 a week doing these show cards and posters. So me being the bright young guy that I was, I thought, well, I can make money at this. I want to be a sign writer. That's what I want to be, a sign writer. So I went around all of the sign writing companies in the city of Tauranga, where I live, and I said, hey guys, I can do this sign writing thing, have it a job. They looked at me and said, you don't have any legs. Thought it was pretty clever of them, really, wasn't it? Not much got past them. I said, yeah, but I can do this sign writing thing, have it a job. They said, well, you haven't got any legs, you can't climb ladders, you can't climb trestles, you can't drive the truck, so you're no good to us. My story is that I pestered one guy long enough, he gave me an opportunity. At the end of 3 months, he made me foreman. Right through today, I owned that company for 13 years, turned it into one of the most successful sign writing companies, in fact, in Australasia. When I took it over, I had a staff of two, turned over less than $90,000 a year. I sold that company in December 1998 as a multi-million dollar company. You see, for me, that's my measure of success. But believe me, success is a journey, something we strive and achieve every day of our lives. If I had a dollar for every time I was told I couldn't do something, be a billionaire today. I believe when we're born, we don't know can't, wouldn't, shouldn't, couldn't, get real. And don't waste your time. We're taught all of those things by other people. It's up to us to decide whether we believe that or not. My art teacher said to me once, Christensen, you're absolutely hopeless. You will never have anything to do with art in your life. I wished I could have employed her. Just so I could fire her. Things I enjoyed about sign writing is we'd be on trestles just like this, twice, three times the height of this. There'd be three of us up here. We'd be sign writing the face of a building, but only two pairs of legs hanging over the side. People go, how the hell do you do that? They used to ask me to climb down just so you see how I got back up again. Look, one of the challenges that I face in my life today, look, I think it's a challenge we all face in one way or another, and that's the challenge of people's perceptions. Other people's perceptions of who we are and what we believe. See, we're in a world where we judge people. We're in a world where we put people in boxes. Because I get, oh, you're one of those disabled people, so we'll stick you in a box over there. Oh, you're with that 21st century group, aren't you? So we'll sort of put you in a box over there. Oh, Jamie, we'll put you in a box over there. You know, we're in a world where we judge people rather than allow ourselves to share our passion, our beliefs, simply be the best. This thing about people's perception. My wife and I, we go out for dinner, the waiter will go up to her and say, would you like a drink? It's like, hello? She says, I don't know, ask him. When they do, I go, ah! I'm sitting in my chair. People come up, they go, how you doing, all right? So look, I haven't got any legs, I'm not deaf. But that's people's perception. In fact, in my business life, I would go out to quote the sign writing of a 20 meter wall. I'd jump out of the back of my van into my chair, go up to the client, the look on their face. Oh, geez, he hasn't got any legs. I wonder if I should tell him. Guys, have we all, All heard of the 90-second rule? The 90-second rule in life? Anybody here? No? 90-second? Write this one down. Come on. You've got 90 seconds in life to make a first impression. 90 seconds to make a first impression, because that is the only impression you will ever leave. You see, you never get a second chance at a first impression. The challenge I face in my life because of people's perception. In my business life, I had 30 seconds. I had 30 seconds to convince those clients that choosing me and my company was the best option that they could take. You see, it is all about an attitude. It's about a desire. It's about a belief. It's about that simple belief that success will come to me. Motorsport's a great passion of mine. My good friend Ewan Cameron and I, we race an off-road racing truck together. This truck's four-wheel drive, 600 horsepower, capable of over 130 miles an hour. Ewan's the driver, I'm the co-driver navigator. We were leading the Woodhill 100 off-road race just north of Auckland, one of New Zealand's premier off-road events. At over 120 miles an hour along the Murawai beachfront, the truck had a rut in the sand and an end over ended three times, finishing upside down. We'd ruptured the fuel tank, fuel and all pouring out of the back of the truck. I looked across at Ewan and I said, mate, are you all right? He said, yeah, I'm okay. I said, this is not good. We better get out of here. Something I've got to tell you about Ewan is that he has an artificial leg. So the joke is we've only got one good leg between the two of us. But the truck's upside down, the fuel's pouring out without even thinking about it, under my seatbelt, land straight on my head. I think that's why I've got the squashed up fat neck here. But anyway, Ewan got his artificial leg jammed between the accelerator and the brake pedal. So I shuffled around the sand. I undid his artificial leg for him. Ewan put his hand on the roof, under the belt, slid out of the truck. And he's hopping away on one leg, trying to keep his balance, leaning against the truck. I'm sitting in the sand, rubbing my neck. The story goes that another competitor saw the accident, went back to the pit area, said to the officials, you'd better get an ambulance down on the beachfront. There's a horrific accident down there. Now they looked at him quite puzzled because we were going to be the first car through. He said, no, I'm serious. One guy's got his leg cut off, the other guy's buried up to his waist in sand. When the officials heard that, they thought, oh, not those clowns again. In fact, I can't remember anybody even coming to get us that day. For me, that's what my life's like. It's a lot of fun. I believe that if you don't enjoy it, don't do it. I believe that we're on this earth for a good time, not always a long time. I got a short piece of video, in fact, one of three that I want to share with you today, showing you some of the things that I enjoy doing in my life. This first piece of video, you will see skydiving. I've now done 7 skydives, 3 tandem, 4 solo skydives. The solo skydives where we landed in Lake Taupo, with life jackets on, obviously landing on the ground wasn't an option. So from 6,000 feet, static line, straight out, unbelievable. You'll see cars racing in the second part, see if you can work out which ones I'm driving. The third part, New Zealand wheelchair basketball team. I represented New Zealand for 8 years with wheelchair basketball. And then the last one, you'll see some of New Zealand's spectacular scenery with a bit of a story. Anyway, if you please, watch the screens.
Winning, well, it's time to make your plan. Don't question reasons, but question how to act. It's time to break the shackles, it's time to attack. Reach for the sky, reach for the sky, reach for the sky, and let's fly. Storm clouds circling, and there's nowhere left to run. It's the speed of others hurtling. You know your journey has begun. If the distance is your vision, you don't ever want to lose. Make the right decision, it's yours to choose. Reach for the sky, reach for the sky, reach for the sky. Let's fly. expectations. It's time to break the chains. Just pick the destination to wash away the stains. Some men are grounded and I don't even know why. Don't say how far, say how high. Reach for the sky, reach for the sky. Let's fly.
You see in the cars racing, and obviously I was driving each one of them, I actually offered the guys here, if anybody needed a shuttle ride into town, I could probably help them out. A good friend of mine saw that piece of video and he said to me, gee, Tony, you crash a lot. And I had to think about that for a little while. And I've been racing different forms of motorsport for, gosh, well over 35, well, in fact, 40 years now. And I've always gone on the theory that, you know, hopefully you'll agree with me, that the more that you do something, the more opportunity there is for things to go wrong. Would you agree with that? Yeah, yeah. Well, he said to me, no, the more you do something, the better you should get at it. So I have to rethink my bit of a theory on that one. But I also think motorsport for me is a very good analogy of life. You see, as a race car driver, if I follow the person in front of me, where am I going to finish the race? Second or behind, right? But I'm a leader, not a follower. And leaders take risks. So for me to pass the guy in front of me, to go for that win, I have to take a risk. Do a lot of speedway, sprint car, and saloon racing. And there's a concrete wall, 20 meter wide track. Now, if the car's on the inside, I have a narrow margin to pass that car. And with that comes risk. And I do crash sometimes, but I win a heck of a lot of races as well. Because I'm a leader in life and not a follower. You also saw in the last part there, some of that spectacular scenery. And you saw a young man from South Korea. His name is Kim Yoon. Kim came to New Zealand about 7 years ago now, and he was one of South Korea's most promising young male actors in New Zealand to film a documentary. While there, he was involved in a horrific car accident, which left him a quadriplegic. Later that year when I met him, we took him out tandem skydiving, pushed out an airplane, whitewater rafting, jet boat racing, and that was another documentary that was filmed and shown on Korean television about 6 months later. Those little insets were Kim's parents, as they hadn't seen him since he'd left over a year beforehand. You see, for people like Kim, life will never ever be the same. I can be here today and tell you that life's not fair. Life's not always fair, because I said, why me? Why me? Why did this have to happen to me? I was 9 years old. Why couldn't it have been anybody else but me? The answer really is, why not me? For me, the reality of life is it's not what happens to you, it's what you do about it that makes a difference. I actually believe that if losing my legs is the worst thing that's going to happen in my life, the rest of it's going to be great. Because they took away my legs, they didn't take my heart, they didn't take my passions, they didn't take my desires to succeed in life. You see, for me, it's about being the best. That's all I know, my mum and dad, my brother, my sister, my family, my friends, my teachers, my workmates, my customers ever asked of me is be the best. I also know as a goal setter that this world will only give me exactly what I ask for, nothing more, nothing less. People come to me and they say, Tony, you're so lucky you got run over by a train and lost your legs. Alrighty. They tell us that adversity makes us a better person, don't they? You've all heard that? You've all heard that a challenge in your life, it's going to make you dig down deep inside and bring out the best in us. We've all had that one, haven't we? My question is, why do we wait? Why do we wait? Why are most people sitting around in their lives waiting for something to happen, waiting for something bad to happen before they go out, accept and create the challenges of life and simply be the best? We're in a world where we're told, if you're not a winner, you're a loser. And if you're not a success, you're a failure. We get examples of it all the time, especially in sport, don't we? What's happening tonight? The rugby league in Britain. Kiwis against the Aussies. Losers. It's not about winning or losing, it's how you play the game. It's about being the best. This thing about winning or losing, I entered a weightlifting competition in New Zealand about 14 years ago now. It was an able-bodied weightlifting competition. I entered the bench press. I won the event with a lift of 220 kilos. The officials came up to me afterwards and said, Tony, awesome lift, well done. You've been disqualified. I asked them why. They said that one of the other competitors had brought it to their attention that rule 16 bar 2 clearly states that all competitors must wear the appropriate footwear. Wouldn't you believe it? The day I go and do well, I forget to take my shoes. That is a true story, a true story. Guys, I believe the greatest challenge we face in life today is communication. Simple communication. Look, for me to be here today to share some of my story, but as I said, each and every one of you have got an extraordinary story. For you to take the time out of your busy lives to come along here, to better yourselves, and to share the passion. Communication comes in so many different ways. And I've got a few examples. Now look, I'm rounding, guys. Have any of you guys here, have you ever been told that you're not communicating by your wife? Well, I'll be honest. I got that. My wife said to me, Tony, we're not communicating. Most of the time I think you don't listen to me. At least I think that's what she said. All those years ago when I had this accident, in New Zealand we have accident compensation. Over here you have workers' comp. I had my accident before accident compensation came in. When ACC came in, they had a little chart, and it was, they call it lump sum days. And if you had an accident, they actually gave you a lump sum rather than feeding it out to you. And they had this chart, they had a schedule, and it said if you lost an eye, you got $10,000. If you lost an arm, $15,000. Lost a leg, $25,000. My parents and I, we would have got $50,000. But no, the old social welfare system. And even today, I have a social welfare number. They call it WINS, Work and Income New Zealand. I got a letter from WINS several years ago. It read, Dear Mr. Christensen, we note on a review of your files, you are a double amputee. Do you expect your condition to improve within the next 12 months? Now here's another one. Now insurance companies, anybody here involved in the insurance industry? Anybody here? No, I wouldn't admit to it either, would you? Unbelievable. Insurance companies drive you nuts. I had to have a new life insurance policy in February this year. Went to the doctor, what is it, blood test, blood pressure, the whole deal. Doctor said, Tony, sit on the scales. I sat on the scales. He went over to his desk, he brought out a chart. It's the height to weight ratio chart. He's looking at the chart, he said, Tony, at 1 meter high, you should weigh 19 kilos. Yeah, my arm weighs 19 kilos. Oh, look, now, we have a legislation in New Zealand, being the very influential country it is in the world, as you know, we have legislation in New Zealand. It will come to Australia. We gave you GST, didn't we? There's legislation in New Zealand that is a manager employee. How many manager employee staff here today? Most of you employees, a couple of you here, right? Legislation in New Zealand that as the manager and employer of staff, you can be fined $500,000 for causing staff mental stress. Serious, that is legislation in New Zealand. It will come to Australia by a Labor government. $500,000 for causing staff mental stress. The maximum fine in New Zealand for vehicular manslaughter is $20,000. It just shows you the mixed communication you get from the government when they tell you that somebody's mental state is worth more than their life. But you see, as an employee, I worked it out that if I had a stressed employee, run him over. Hey, just back over in the car park, save yourself 480 grand. You know, I don't make the rules. Now, when I say I'm fortunate to be here, I also mean from the point of view that all those years ago when I had this accident, many people didn't survive the horrific injuries I had. Look, we're in a world today where we glue people back together and we call it quality of life. Many people didn't survive those injuries. The doctors came up to my parents. They said, Mr. and Mrs. Christensen, we are so sorry to have to tell you, Tony will either spend the rest of his life in a hospital, in a home. He may not even live past the age of 20 years old. The pressures of life with these horrific injuries will be so great. Obviously, that really upset my mum. I got past the age of 20 years old. They sent me to a psychiatrist. I was in there for 3 hours with that man. It took me that long to straighten him out. Man, it gives them hang-ups. You see, that's people's perception. All those years ago, we were called crippled. What a terrible word, crippled. Then we were called disabled and handicapped. Nowadays, we're called physically challenged. In my case, vertically challenged. Actually, my son thought it was great. I was the only dad that could go to the McDonald's playground because Ronald says you must be this high to enter. I got stuck in that tube thing a while ago. Little buggers were sitting there throwing the balls at me. But anyway, that's another story. I had the opportunity to go to Africa. The opportunity came through KBS Television, Korean Broadcasting Service, and they were doing a documentary. Now, the documentary was to be on myself, a lady named Soo Yong, who was totally blind, and a man named Hong Bin, who had lost both his hands to frostbite in a climbing accident. During this expedition, we were to go to Ngorongoro National Park, which is one of the most extraordinary national parks in Tanzania, inside a volcanic crater. We were to stay in a Maasai village for 3 days. And then we were to go on to Mount Kilimanjaro, Africa's highest mountain at 5,895 metres high, or 19,500 feet. You climb it without the aid of oxygen. Kilimanjaro is the fifth highest mountain in the world. A little bit of background on Kilimanjaro and the expedition. The climb itself was to take us 13 days. 4,000 people attempt to climb it every year. Around 1,400 will make it to the summit. And more than 100 people have died of altitude sickness on Kilimanjaro. As I said, the climb was to take us 13 days. We would be climbing around 18 hours per day, and I was to do around 80% of it on my hands and my backside. At 5,000 metres, Kibo Hut, the last hut before the summit, it's minus 15 degrees. At the summit, it is around minus 25 to minus 35 degrees. During the climb at Kibo Hut, Soo Yong and Hong Bin, as well as most of the television crew, in fact, gained altitude sickness. They had to go back down to Horombo Hut at 3,000 metres to reacclimatise for 4 days. I didn't get altitude sickness, and I waited for them to come back. Now, as I said, Kibo Hut's at minus 15 degrees at 5,000 metres. Up there, there's no food, there's no water, there's no heating. All I could do was wait. The only water that could be brought up was from 4,000 metres, which was mountain water, and it had all the bugs in it. So I used to drink water with Puritabs in it. Anybody drank water with Puritabs in it before? Absolutely vile stuff, isn't it? It's like drinking chlorine and iodine together. It's vile stuff, and I'd had to drink about 4 litres of that a day to stay hydrated up there. And I waited for them to come back, and then we only had one day, to make it to the summit. That climb took me 21 hours to get from Kibo Hut to the summit and return. So if I could now, I'd like to share with you my climb of Kilimanjaro. So again, if you please, watch the screens.
Oh, Tony. Tony, 수고 많으셨어요.
Know me, know what's inside your mind, your heart, and see. Close your eyes and make a start. The single seed that we sow and soon the branches will grow. This is make-believe without the dreaming. You can take my hand and climb to the top, ride stormy waters and you won't wanna stop. You can chase all your wishes and capture your dreams. You can do anything you want if you know what I mean.
Okay.
Oh, oh, oh. He's going.
Oh, oh, oh.
Mama said, learn how to walk before you run. But I felt the wind in my face and the joy of much more fun. The river returns to the sea as the spirit strives to be free. Eyes wide open. So why do you see tomorrow? Well, you can take my hand and climb to the top, ride stormy waters and you won't wanna stop. You can chase all your wishes and capture your dreams. You can do anything you want if you know what I mean. And there is no need to find, the answer is there inside. If you find you're alone again, understand the words I've said. Well, you can take my hand and climb to the top, ride stormy waters and you won't want to stop. You can chase all your wishes and capture your dreams. You can do anything you want if you know what I mean.
Thank you.
by climbing Kilimanjaro. You saw we stayed in the Maasai village for those 3 days there, and there was cow dung that they mix up in those pots, those little aluminium pots, and they smear it over the huts for insulation. The next picture you saw was ugali. Ugali is stiff porridge, and they mixed it in the same pot. A lot of people see that piece of video and they ask me, did I ever want to give up? Look, giving up was never an option. So the answer is no. I will never, ever, ever give up at the things that I'm passionate about in life. My mum calls me arrogant. She's a little 83-year-old and she calls me arrogant. Arrogant little bugger, in fact. But what she sees is arrogance is determination. I have a burning desire to succeed in my life at the things that I choose. And I will never, ever, ever give up. We are in a world where we're told if you're not a winner, you're a loser. And that if you're not a success, you're a failure. I have two plaques on my office wall. One reads, no, is not an option. The other one reads, can't, is not an option. We are in a world where we believe no and we believe can't. Someone comes along to you and says, oh no, you can't do that. We go, oh, okay, I won't do it then. And we don't do it. We make the choices. Each and every one of us in this room have the opportunity and the potential in our lives for greatness. We simply have to know what it is to us. That's why I'm a goal setter. I'm a planner. I don't have time to waste. I'm 54 years old. I'm just over halfway through my life. I've got the best half yet to come. I haven't got time to be disappointed. I don't have time to regret. And I don't have time to blame other people. I only have time to go out, accept and create those challenges and simply be the best. Look, I'm inspired in my life. I'm inspired in my life by the achievements I've seen of people far worse off than I am. I'm inspired in my life by people like Sir Edmund Hillary. People ask me, how do I find the time? How do I find the time to bring up a family, to have successful businesses, to travel the world, to do all these experiences, race cars, fly airplanes? I've got the same amount of hours in my day as you have. We've all got the same amount of hours in our day as anybody famous, you know, Sir Edmund Hillary, Florence Nightingale, the Wright brothers. It's what you do with those hours that makes the difference. And that's why you are here. You are here to learn. I'm fortunate in my life because I learnt very early on. And one of the things that I learnt is I do not have time to waste. Procrastination is the killer of time. I believe in myself. That's why my mum calls me arrogant, I suppose. I believe in myself. I believe that success will come to me. And you know what? I don't get up in the morning thinking, oh, geez, I've got to go and do this and go and sort this out. I've got to go and talk to this customer. Oh, God, I've got to go and fly on this airplane. Oh, I don't want to do. I'll go to the chemist shop. I'll go to the pharmacy. That's what I'll do. I'll buy a box of motivation. Here's 20 bucks. Oh, the old attitude needs a bit of work. I'll go and buy a box of attitude. Here's another $20. You don't buy it. Well, it's probably a legal drug or something like that. I don't know. It's right here. Each and every one of them in this room have it. Our challenge is how do we bring it out? People think I'm an extraordinary person. No, I'm not.
Yes, you are.
No, I'm not. I'm an ordinary person. I just choose to do some extraordinary things. Any one of you can climb Kilimanjaro. It might be extraordinary I do it without legs. Any one of you could learn to fly an aeroplane. It might be extraordinary I do it without legs. But in my life, it's an ordinary thing to do. It's about perception. So many people have the perception of their lives that I can't do that. No matter how hard I try, I'd never be able to do that. And if that's not good enough, that's just tough. If you tell yourself that enough times, you will start to believe it. Because the world gives you exactly what you ask for. Nothing more, nothing less. I have the opportunity to travel around the world. When I flew over, we all fly business class, right?
Yeah. Not yet.
Hey? What's the selling point of business class? Leg room. I'm trying to sublease. Get a family down here to sort of put them in the front. I was in Washington, D.C. not that long ago. And went to the Smithsonian Institute for Aviation. Aviation's a passion of mine. Anybody ever been to the Smithsonian in Washington? Anybody here? Okay, a couple of you, great. Absolutely amazing place. You go into the door, the main doorway there, and you see the Wright brothers, the first plane, that the Wright brothers first flew. I'll talk about aviation, I get a bit enthusiastic. Amazing. Now this airplane, it's thin pieces of timber, held together with thin wires and covered in a rag cloth. And Orville Wright's laying on the wing steering it. And I read the story of the Wright brothers. Now, like most of us, I thought the first flight of the Wright brothers was the 17th of December 1908. But in fact, it wasn't. The first flight of the Wright brothers was 10 days beforehand. And that was when the aircraft was pushed off a 100-foot sand bluff at Kitty Hawk. After reading that story, I thought about the sheer belief that Orville Wright had that that airplane was going to fly, because if it didn't, he was going to die. Do you know that one act of the Wright brothers changed our lives forever? In less than 100 years, we went from man-powered flight to landing men on the moon, or so they say. Every moment, every second of every day, there are over 500,000 people flying around the earth. You know what? From every great idea in this world has come from somebody's dream. Every great idea in this world has come from somebody's dream. Don't ever stop dreaming. Don't let anybody ever take your dreams away. But also don't be a dream taker. Be a dream creator. And only you can do that. Each and every one of us had the same opportunity. It's what you do about it that makes a difference. Look, when I was in Washington, on the way out, there were three of us in our group. We'd just flown in the day before, a little bit of jet lag, in fact. Now, we were an hour early for our bus back to the hotel. Beautifully manicured lawns, a couple of palm trees. I jumped out of my chair, took my cap off, and I fell asleep. And do you know, I woke 3/4 of an hour later with $15 in my hand. I thought, only in America, I love this place. Everywhere I went after that, I'd just sort of fall out of my chair, take my hat. I would always get a couple of bucks. That's people's perception. In fact, I was here at the casino only about 4 weeks ago with a group of friends. They all went off to the bathroom. So I sat outside, took my cap off, waiting patiently, and a Japanese couple came up and put $10 in my hat. Honestly, I thought this was great. I wheeled up to them to give it back and they started running. Maybe they thought it wasn't enough, I don't know. You see, that's people's perception. You see how people judge me? They have no idea what I can achieve. And I believe that you have no idea what you can achieve. It's about being the best. I've got a four-wheel racing bike, quad sport racing bike. You seen them? Unbelievable things. I just have trouble staying on the seat. My friends reckon they're going to stick Velcro to my pants. We had a trail ride not that long ago in a place called Pitaru in New Zealand. And it was a really muddy, wet day. And there were seven of us in our group. And I'm leading the group, sliding my bike around the corner, having such a great time. We came around a corner, the bog hole in front of us. It was half the size of this room, trees down either side, no way past. But me being the brave guy I am, I looked back to my mates and said, don't worry about it, guys, I'll go through it first. I hit the bog at great speed, the bike stopped, and I kept going straight out over the handlebars into the mud. But you see, it wasn't that deep, it was only up to here at me. And I got my gumboots on, you know, the yellow plastic PVC pants, right? With the ends sewn up. So I got my gumboots on, sitting in the mud. And these so-called mates, having a great laugh at my expense, I said, come on, you guys, stop mucking around. Help me push the bike out, will you? They started to push the bike out, and as they were doing so, another group of riders came round the corner. And it was a race, actually, between our two groups. But in the spirit of fair play, we said, look, guys, come around here, you get away, no problem at all. They didn't listen to us. They rode their bike just straight into the ditch, just the back on the back wheel sticking out of the mud on the side. It's just, we said, you Wallies, what did you do that for? We're telling you to come round this path here. They looked at us all as serious as could be. So you buggers are having us on. Look how deep it is my ears. I sort of went like out of the mud and I sat on the side, the look on their faces. We hopped on the bike, took off, come back an hour later and they're still going, I can't believe this. The moral of the story is all is not what it seems in this world, and sometimes opportunities aren't always where we expect them to be. Over these few days, you've all been given information and opportunities. The reality is that that's all it'll ever stay until you do something about it. Because we are in a world where it's too easy to blame other people for the things that go wrong in our lives, rather than accept and create those challenges and simply be the best. I'm inspired and modeled. How many have seen the movie The World's Fastest Indian? A few of you here? Look, for those that haven't seen it, do get the movie. Burt Munro from Invercargill in his 1927 Indian motorcycle. Burt's dream at the age of 69 years old was to go to the Bonneville Salt Flats in the USA to do a speed of 200 miles an hour. For those that haven't seen the movie, get it out. It is a great movie, even though it is a Kiwi movie. His story, I'm inspired by Burt Munro. I actually saw the movie 27 times. It was the only movie that any New Zealand had for about 5 years, I think. 18th of August 2008, I thought I could do that. And I took my drag car to the Bonneville Salt Flats in the USA to do a speed of 200 miles an hour. Didn't quite get there, did 190 miles an hour. Planning on going back next year with a new car to do a speed of 221 miles an hour, just under 400 kilometres an hour. For a world speed record. One person in this room that they can make it happen, that's me. I'm inspired by Burt Munro. I'm also inspired by the Jamaican bobsled team. I've been driving the two-man bobsled at Olympic Park in Utah for the last 3 years. Go back in January again, with that being a possibility of being an Olympic sport, a Winter Paralympic sport in 2018 in Seoul, Korea. Again, one person in the room today that can make it happen. So what I'd like to do is just share with you some more of the things that I enjoy doing in my life. Listen to the words of the song. So please watch the screens.
Do you see what I see? A rainbow shining over us. In the middle of a hopeless storm. Oh. Sometimes I'm blinded by my feelings, and I can see beyond my troubled mind. Afraid of what I'll find, the story of our lives, but there's tomorrow. 'Cause the rain goes away, I pray, yeah. Do you need a friend right now? The road that you're going to. If you get lost, just call me, I'll be there. Yes, I'll be right there.
I don't think I took a breath for 2 miles.
We're here at the top of the Olympic track in Park City, Utah, USA, the site of the 2002 Olympic Games.
Hey,
got technical knowledge and his race car background.
Yeah.
Oh, thank you, guys!
That's the green light.
Jimmy!
Wider field of athletes, disabled athletes, participate in the Paralympic Games.
I can share a story, I can show you some of the things that I do in my life to fulfill me and my passions and my desires of what I believe success is. And if people can gain inspiration from that and think and see that anything's possible, then that's great.
And that's really it for me. It's about believing in yourself. You are in control of your own destiny. You make the choices. You are here to make choices. And the world will give you what you ask for. Nothing more, nothing less. What are you doing next weekend? Because I know what I'm doing. 139 miles an hour. Kilometres an hour, sorry. At 5.2 Gs in the turns. In the bobsled. I can't wait. Thank you so much for your time.
Come on, Melbourne, make some more noise than that. Come on, give it up for him. Give it up, give it up, give it up. Outstanding. Totally outstanding presentation. So, on behalf of all of Melbourne, we thank you for taking the time to be here today. You are amazing as always. So Tony has some products, some programs out the back there, out the front. And you go out there and check it out, because I'm telling you, the information, what he has, will definitely change your life.